Hello and welcome to EastEnders Weekly Extra, your monthly podcast all about Sean Mann.
That's right. As you may have seen by the description, this is a special edition where we got to speak to Ray Kelly, or obviously played by Sean Mann, all about his time on the square, but also his progression to getting to being in EastEnders.
Yes, he's very nice. And it was a good chat.
It was a really lovely interview with Sean, and we appreciate him giving up some of his time for us. We hope you guys enjoy it.
So we're joined by Sean Mann, who played a lover, a bigamist and a killer on the square, known more commonly as Ray Kelly, but to his friends and second and third wives as many other different aliases. He left the soap in an adrenaline-filled final episode, which aired at the beginning of this year. Luckily, he sprung from his shallow grave one last time to join us, and he's on the line now. Thank you for joining us, Sean. It's great to hear from you.
You too, guys. You too. Happy New Year.
Happy New Year to you too. not quite so much of a happy New Year to Ray.
Well, no, he's alive and well. So what should I say? I'm alive and well. So that's good.
That's the main thing. So you started off your career in the United States, where you work, first of all, in a different job.
I grew up in Ireland, and I moved to the States in my 20s. And I had a background in business, and I was over there as a brand and marketing manager for a company. And I was living in Chicago at the time. And I essentially, towards the end of my 20s, decided that I wanted to pursue acting, because it had been an ambition and a goal of mine from a very young age, but I didn't have the wherewithal to do it back at home. So I quit my job. I did a full-time program in Chicago, and from there, I moved out to Los Angeles, lived there for maybe 7 or 8 years, and really started my TV and film work there in Chicago. Was primarily theater. And then from Los Angeles, I then moved to New York and did a lot of theater there. And then from there to London, and then into film and television, and then to Ireland, and then back to New York, and then to London. So it's been a bit of a movable feast for the last number of years.
My gosh, yeah. Moved to where the work was, I presume.
Yeah, I think, you know, it's a classic wandering minstrel, that where you go wherever you can when the project is right. And it really grabs you. I think it's important to you want to be available. So it has its upsides, because there's a lot of excitement that goes with moving around, obviously, but it also has its pitfalls, in that you never really, really sit still.
Yeah, I was going to say, it must be quite hard to like put down any roots while you're moving around.
Yeah, I think, you know, I think it's a bit of a personality thing as well. A lot of artists are Rolling Stones, so I think there's a time and a place for everything. It suits you until it doesn't. And then you see a lot of people in this business start taking jobs or looking for work that will actually hold them in one place. And that's actually something like a lot of the characters that work on EastEnders, for example, who are so fortunate to be able to work on great material with great people and still have, you know, a regular, consistent life in one place.
That's part of the advantages of that soap work, isn't it? It's the one job
completely
that sort of is that closest to a 9-to-5 job you can get on soaps.
You're right. That kind of continuing drama and sitcoms and that regular work, it does lend itself.
And I was just going to ask, like, when you were over in America, starting up acting for like the very first time, what was your sort of first big break that you thought, oh, hold on, I've kind of started to make it now? Was there a particular project which you see as your first big thing that you've done?
Yes and no. I think because I started late, I was just really happy to get jobs when I got them.
Right.
So they started out as smaller guest roles on TV shows. I think my first television job was as a truck driver on the TV show Angel, which was a spin-off of Buffy the Vampire Slayer.
Oh, yeah.
And when I actually auditioned for that, I auditioned for two parts on the same day. One for a part in a movie called The Hulk, which was, you know, the original version of The Hulk with Eric Bana. And then the further later on the afternoon, I went and auditioned for Buffy, and I got both those parts. And I thought, wow, okay, looks like I'm on my way. But as is true in this industry, there's lots of strikeouts as well as lots of strikes. So I think certainly in Los Angeles, there was a number of those smaller parts, and really just building my resume. or CV, as you like to call it. But probably the biggest break I got when I felt as if, okay, I've taken a big jump was when I went from Los Angeles to New York and I was cast in a play on Broadway and moved to New York in that kind of capacity. And that really, I really felt like, okay, this is an upswing.
Yeah, it's because you did, it was a couple of Broadway shows. It's 39 Steps and The Seafarer.
That's right. So both shows moved from London over to New York. The Seafarer was the first one that I did. And that was kind of like a launching pad. And then once you get known in the New York theater community, like anywhere, you're up for the roles. And then this part in 39 Steps, the lead guy, Charlie Edwards, had been doing it for a year. He'd also done it in London. He left and I took over and I ran that for a year as well on Broadway, which was great.
Did Charlie Edwards give you any hints of how to play the role, or did you want to play the role your way?
You know, I didn't actually meet Charlie. Charlie kind of came and went, and they didn't encourage us to talk to the other characters or actors who play the similar character. They wanted you to take your spin on it, but obviously fit within the mold of the play.
Yeah.
So, which is good, because obviously it gives the show a new bump of life and a new perspective.
Absolutely. After then your time on Broadway, you got a role on Red Rock. It worked quite immediately after that, was it? Or was there still a bit of a...
No, actually, I from after New York, I moved to London because I was starting to feel that I wanted to closer to home, to Ireland. And I had a UK agent and they said, come to the UK and I'll be close enough to Dublin.
Yeah.
And so I moved to London, and actually I did a movie here, Philomena. And that was a wonderful experience. Obviously, tremendous actors and tremendous director and producers. So that elevated me, I suppose, in a certain way, and just in terms of visibility.
Yeah.
And from there, then, while in London, I started auditioning for a lot of material in Ireland, which I had not had any access to before because I didn't know the marketplace and it didn't know me.
Uh-huh.
And I did a film over in Ireland called The Legend of Longwood, which is kind of a children's adventure movie. And from that, the casting director brought me in for Red Rock, maybe two years later, and then Red Rock came into the equation, and I moved from, at this point I'd moved back to New York, and then I got the Red Rock thing, and then I moved to Ireland, which was originally what I always wanted to do, was to be in Dublin. So to be able to go back to Dublin, having left as a business person, and to go back and realize what my dreams were professionally as an actor was great. And it turned out to be
quite a dark character you're playing this time.
Yes. So up to that point, really, the characters I had been playing were good people. This was kind of my first foray into probably the darker, more sinister side of character work. The character's name was Brian McGonagall. He was a sergeant in a police station and kind of the alpha male of the station. And kind of had the run of the place and pretty much called the shots.
Yeah.
And it was discovered by a young up-and-coming guard. Her name is Sharon Queer, played by the wonderful Jay McGrath. She's pursuing some footage of a potential theft and comes across footage of McGonagall, my character, kissing a 15-year-old girl who turns out to be his daughter's best friend. So it became about this.
So you were caught. It was during an investigation, wasn't it? And it was on CCTV footage. And
that's right. That's exactly right. Yes. So the young guard she gets it into her craw to expose McGonagall, and then it becomes very much a back and forth about bullying within the force and this ultimate takedown and this back and forth between these two characters. And the storyline was meant to be set for one season, but because it ran so successfully, I came back for a second season and played out how it would go with not only Sharon Clear at this point, but also the young girl who I had the affair with.
Yeah, because it ended up with your character. It was almost in like a whodunit murder storyline. Ended up being.
It did. Yes. They brought it back to find out who killed me. You tend when you play these parts to get shot. I was trying to figure out how many times I've been shot on film, and I kind of gave up. Shot or bludgeoned over the head
with a lead pipe. So obviously after Red Rock, you worked with John York on a few episodes of Red Rock. Is that where you got talking about the role as Ray on EastEnders?
Well, John was one of the executive producers on Red Rock, and I met him a number of times back and forth when he was just on set, essentially. Mm-hmm. So we got to know each other, and then my time in Red Rock ended, and John resumed a role at EastEnders as exec producer. And then time went by, a year, maybe two, I think. And John reached out about this particular part that they had created to, I guess, bolster Mel's storyline and to propel it in a certain direction. And asked if I was interested. And of course I said yes. And the rest is, well, you know the rest.
We certainly do. The past 5 months of Ray's history has been played out in front of us, and it's been a very exciting time for him. So he was introduced, obviously, by his stepson Hunter, and Ray and Hunter had a very strong bond, but one that sometimes became weaker. Do you think Ray always considered Hunter as his son, or was it always someone he could play as a pawn?
Well, I think it's neither one thing nor the other. I think Ray had a very strong relationship with both with Mel and Hunter, and considered them very much his family. But within that, you have a personality of someone who is very much a narcissist and a bully who uses his tactics to get what he wants. So you can still love somebody and treat them badly, which is what he does and did.
So do you think Ray really did love Mel then? He wasn't always lying to
him? Oh, I mean, I think lying was part of his MO, how he got through the day. I mean, certainly he was an undercover cop, and he had license to lie. That was part of his gig. And living these separate lives gave him a charge that kind of fueled him through his professional and personal life. So lying to him was easy, and it was a way of getting what he wanted. But that did not deny the fact that he very much cared for Mel. I think he loved her in his way, almost like a possession.
Yeah.
And the idea of her being with somebody else was not a possibility.
Yeah, it's funny because he didn't mind him sharing, Ray didn't mind sharing himself around, but when it became to either Mel or Nicola or Maddie, he didn't like sharing them with anyone else. So as soon as he has that...
Well, yeah.
Yeah.
That's the typical narcissist who believes that he's the center of the universe, and everything should operate and revolve around him. And it was a game. It was very much a game that he got a charge out of, and that he enjoyed as well.
When you were called in initially to EastEnders, was the story laid down in front of you? Did you know what was happening from the very beginning to the very end? Did you know that your ultimate end would be what it was?
I didn't. No. And I think that's the beauty of continuing drama. It evolves based upon how the character evolves, and it's the character's interaction with other people. So I'm sure the producers had their beginning, middle, and end in mind. But I only found out what was going on as I got scripts.
Yeah.
Which is exciting in its own way, but also brings with it the technique of planning out what your arc is and how you're going to play it. And so it's quite a tricky bit of business.
It is, because throughout the storylines, they integrated Ray with quite a few different characters around the square, because you've got quite a few scenes with Phil and Sharon and everyone in the Minute Mart. So you were all around the community.
That was very much a discussion. So that was a discussion at the beginning. The writers wanted to make sure that Ray was part of the world and just didn't exist by himself. and just didn't float in and out of Nell's world, and no one else knew who he was or didn't know who he was. So that was a conscious effort, and that was something I really appreciated, because not only because it gives the character more life, but also the opportunity to meet with and work with these titans of industry within the EastEnder world.
Yeah, it rounds off Ray a bit more as well, doesn't it? It integrates him, so it makes him less of a hidden away character, more of an open... Because Ray, I don't think Ray would ever be someone who would want to hide himself away. He's very brash and open and wants people to know that he's there.
Yeah, he's kind of like cock of the walk. He likes to pump up his chest and walk around and own the space and play games like he did a number of times with Sharon, and even play games with Phil. But everything was about his bravado. So... So to get the opportunity to work with all the characters was great. And then, of course, to have the big showdown at the wedding when all the characters are there looking at you. I mean, as an actor, I was very happy as well.
Yeah. Let's talk about the wedding then. So the build-up, obviously, where Ray discovered that Mel knew everything, and you had the big fight where you ultimately think you choked Mel, and you're acting that you're going to be stood up at the altar. I mean, that scene where when Mel walks in with the scarf around her neck, looking all brash, as if she's got the power now, and Ray's surprised. Mm-hmm. Was it as chilling as it felt when you were watching it?
Yeah, what was great about it was that the director worked very hard to shoot that whole episode and sequence, which really helped with the momentum of everything, because a lot of the time it's shot out of sequence. So to have Mel walk in that dress with that choker on, and obviously for Tamsin to give it the level of, that steel rod kind of like disposition that she exudes. Absolutely. And it just played into this back and forth quality that Ray and Mel have, which is this cat and mouse game. And she obviously was in charge there, and then he's in charge, and then she's in charge. And it's this thing that they do.
Yeah, I mean, from that moment, from the wedding, I think Ray suddenly went from feeling quite cocky to being quite desperate, because the actions following that for Ray weren't quite as cool and level-headed as he had been previously.
Well, no, I mean, because he's not holding the cards. And essentially, when she says she wants to get married, he says, no, I'm not going to do that. And she threatens to expose him and send him to jail. Then from there, he's on the back foot. And he's not a man that's ever used to being on the back foot. He's always kind of leading the charge. So then being arrested by the police, and so everything is new at this point. He's not in control. Being arrested by the police, not having access to his gun or his passports or his money, going back to the house, and his stash not being there, and having to think on his feet and kidnap Hunter. Everything is about, being on the back foot. But he does take charge of the situation, obviously. He kidnaps Hunter and pulls Mel into the forest. And that becomes their kind of their world, where it's back and forth, obviously.
Yeah, the forest scenes were fantastic and really exciting. It felt a bit like a bit like, and this is meant in a lovely way, and like an 80s horror film. It's like the chase and the excitement. Was it fun to film those? I imagine it took all night to film.
That's exactly what it was. We read it and we were like, oh, wow, this is like an old horror, kind of classic horror movie, with her in the bride dress and me running around beating the car with a shovel. And it was all very kind of heightened. And we got the scripts. We're like, how fun is this going to be? And the whole objective was like, okay, we just got to jump into this and really, really buy into it. And even for the first time she goes into the woods and Ray comes screaming at her out of the woods.
Yes.
It's kind of all a little very, very heightened in terms of how surreal it is. And it does take a departure from reality and normalcy. So that was, to do that was really fun to play. And it took us four nights till 4 o'clock in the morning to shoot those scenes. So we'd be called at around 5 or 6 in the afternoon, get into hair and makeup. And obviously we had weather conditions, but late nights, but very fun. And great sense of camaraderie between the actors and the crew and the director.
Yeah, because it must have been quite an intimate filming session, because it was only you, Mel and Hunter, or Charlie and Tamsin, who were filming.
Well, that's it. And it became very much our own little thing. You know, it became this this very kind of small little movie that we were doing. Yeah. And that was, you know, with a lot of these, with a lot of shows that are continuing drama, you do scene and then you're done, you do scene and then you're done. But where we were doing these continuous scenes over the course of 4 days for 8 hours a day. So it felt like this long arc that we got to play together. So it was, for me, it was a great experience and also a great end to the journey I'd taken.
Yeah, for Ray. I mean, so obviously Ray's legacy is going to live on now, even though he is, we presume he's dead, buried in a shallow grave, but we don't know for sure because he's obviously popped out before. So do you think the echo effect from Ray is going to be heard for a little while longer on the square?
I think there has to be. I mean, certainly for Tamsin and for Charlie or Mel and Hunter, there has to be huge ramifications in terms of how it all went down, how it impacts their life. I'm not entirely sure the direction it takes because I no longer get scripts. But from what I understand, it's very exciting.
Lovely. That's excellent. That's great. So is there anything exciting happening on the horizon for Sean in the future?
Yeah, a few things coming up. There's possibly a movie happening in the spring, and I'm heading off to New York in a few weeks for some meetings there. So, stuff in the pipeline. That's always keeps things fresh.
Lovely. Oh, that's fantastic. Well, good luck, obviously, if everything happening for you in the future. Again, thank you ever so much for getting in touch with us. And wishing you all the best in the future.
Well, thanks, guys, and good luck to you, and good luck with the podcast program. And it's been good talking.
Lovely, thank you, thank you very much, Sean.
Thank you.
Okay, take care. Okay, bye bye.
Well, there you have it.
Yes, I hope you guys enjoyed the interview.
As we learned a bit about Ray and his way of thinking.
So. Yeah, I mean, I think Sean sympathised with Ray a little bit by the way he was talking about him, but also understood that Ray is a bit of a bad fella. And someone you shouldn't mess with. We tried to see if he knew any in-depth information or ever Ray was returning, but he wouldn't let on.
He was very tight-lipped.
And we'd just like to thank Sean Mahan once more for giving up his time, for allowing us to conduct the interview with him. It was very generous, and it was a great insight into his character of Ray and his time before EastEnders. And if you liked what you heard, you can always catch our podcast every Sunday on your favourite podcast app, and you can get in touch with us on Twitter at EastEnders Week, Instagram at EastEnders Weekly Podcast. We're on Facebook if you search EastEnders Weekly Podcast, or you can email EastEndersWeekly@gmail.com. And thanks for listening.